It's tough to keep up a sense of urgency right now, but it has to be done. We can't lag. We can't lapse. Okay, it's like a workout. We have to keep going. We have to cross the finish line. So that's what we're doing here. We're exhorting to cross the finish line. Keep going. So it's been condensed down right now into some very basic stuff, and has to do with seeing or being seen. If you want to, first of all, you can say, if you want to see, you must let go of the seer. And Muji says, can the seer be seen? It's another way. But I would say, you have to choose between seeing and being seen. Being seen. If you want to be seen, then you have to drop seeing, drop the seer. Because being seen is not coming from a seer. It's not coming from a personal seer. It's coming from God, actually. So it's coming from the Holy Spirit. In perception, it comes from the Holy Spirit, which comes from God. So we have seeing comes from the ego, comes from our desire to be separate from God. So there's a personal sense in seeing. There's a sense of separation from God, actually. So if we want to be seen, we have to drop the seeing. And being seen is you realize everything is being seen simultaneously. There's no gaps. There's no specialness. And this is what we really want. But we can't have both. We can't have both. One of the great facets of A Course in Miracles is Jesus saying you can't have both. That's a huge, huge emphasis throughout. And it is the key, because we keep saying, well, why don't we have both? Yeah. And that trips us up every time. So if we want to be seen, we have to give up the seer. It's not us that is doing the seeing, in other words. We're not the seer. The sense of personal seership has to be dropped. So this is getting to the nitty-gritty, actually, which is where we need to be. I mean, it may not be able to do it this instant, or maybe we will. But at least in looking at this, we're like looking at the finish line, essentially. What I've noticed in running is that, like running cross country, you're so tired and you're just looking for that finish line, and when you finally see the finish line, you know it's near, and you see it, you say, oh, I just got to put on a complete sprint. And you might get all uncoordinated because you're so tired that when you try to give like a full-on sprint, you just can't keep your steady motion going properly, and you get all out of sorts. So what you have to do is you just have to think of yourself as running through the finish line, not to it, but through it, and maintaining a steady pace and picking up a little bit at a time. So that's what we're doing here. Even though, yes, we do have to finish soon, the finish line is there, we cannot just become completely frantic and freak out and try to put on like a 100-yard dash type of effort. The pace that we're on right now is sufficient to cross the finish line, cross through it. So as we get closer to the finish line, these questions arise in us. If I want real seeing, in other words, real seeing, I have to drop the seer. I have to drop the seer. What is the seer? These questions will arise in us. What is the seer? seeing, dropping the C. Had a dream last night where I was in a car, and suddenly somehow the car turned into an airplane, and I rose up above, and I went and flew out on the coast, and there was the sea. And then I saw all these people down below on the beach trying to see, and then the turbulence pushed the plane. There was a lot of turbulence there. It hit the plane hard. I was able to keep flying though, but it's people trying to do both, trying to see and be seen, both. Let's put it this way, the seer cannot be seen. The seer cannot be seen. And Muji says, can the seer be seen? Let's say, the seer cannot be seen. You're either a seer or you're being seen. Can't do both. So what the ego has us doing is it has us trying to do both. That's the ego's great secret. Its great defense is not to deny, is to say, oh no, do both, you can do both. That is the great trick up its sleeve, do both. Mutual exclusives, work on that. And of course, you can be working on that forever because you can never accomplish it. You can never abide in that, and therefore it's not an accomplishment. So the seer can't be seen. That's why when we're seeing, we feel like we're not being seen. And we try to get others to see us. But you notice as you go out in the world, I've noticed this very much so. Nobody sees me. I think we all have this feeling like we're not being seen. And we used to say everybody's trying to make the scene. You go to parties, everything. What's happening there? Everybody's trying to be seen. They say, maybe at this party I will be seen. But the seer cannot be seen. And now we have all this Thai technology, social networking, and everybody's saying, hey, maybe this will help me be seen. I've got 10,000 friends on Facebook. And that must mean I'm being seen, but I don't quite feel like I'm being seen. So we say the seer cannot be seen. If you want to really see, drop the seer. If you want to see truly, drop the seer, because there everything is seen. The seer wants to be seen specially. Seeing is not special. There's no specialness in true seeing. So when we try to be seen, we have this feeling like we're less than others, and we're not special enough. So we're running towards the finish line here, and we're just looking at what we're seeing as we're running. Okay, going through the territory. Again, no need to be frantic, desperate or frantic. The pace we're on right now crosses the finish line. So all we have to give up is seeing. And then the benefit of that is we're being seen with everything. Everything is being equally seen. So I would just make a slight alteration in saying that it's, instead of seeing everything, it's awareness that everything is being seen. And that's helpful. Everything is being seen. There is a that which is seeing everything. So it's an awareness that everything has always been seen. We were just trying to do the seeing. From a position, was an accumulation. From a point of view. Point of view of something as being excluded. Who? What's being excluded? The seer. Trying to be a seer is really trying to exclude oneself from seeing, from being seen. But no one has ever seen alone. Being seen is always everything. No limits to it. When we always wonder why those who say that they're quote unquote enlightened, being seen, why they seem to be very at peace. It must be that their fears are gone, as far as they don't need to do anything to be seen. Nothing needs to happen for them to be seen. They don't have to. It's not something that needs to be earned. Not something that can be lost. And so they're calm, they're relaxed, they're at peace, they don't have worries about how to be seen. So if we want to be seen, drop the seer. Drop the sense of personal seership. And again, we don't have to get this. What we're doing is we're going towards the finish line, and we're recognizing, okay, this is the territory we're going through now, which is fine. Just get familiar with it. So essentially, there is no finish line, because you won't see it. But what happens is, as you see this, you won't see it. It gets closer to you, so you think you're reaching it, but it's actually you're relinquishing a finish line, because that is something that is seen, a personal sense of seership, seeing enlightenment. No, it's when you give up. The goal of personal finishing, seeing the finish. That you do, quote unquote, finish. We finish by giving up the finish. We see by giving up the seeing. So we could say, well, I'll never see myself finish. That is right. And everybody tells us, all I want for you is for you to see yourself finish. All right, that's the trap, isn't it? That's what we get as we're growing up in the world. We say, look, I don't want much for you, but I just want you to do one thing, is to see yourself finish. See yourself be happy. See, that's impossible. That's the trap that is set here. You hear it over and over and over. All I want for you is always just one little thing. I don't want much for you at all. I just have a very basic desire for you, and that is that you finally one day see yourself. See yourself. Not finish, whatever. See yourself this way. But it really means. All I want for you is to see yourself. You can't see yourself. That's not a little request. That's a request for to be a slave. Slave to death. That's not a little request. You can't see yourself. I remember struggling in the days gone by of going around saying, I can't find myself. I can't see myself. I can't. This is terrible. I'm failing. I'm letting everybody down, because the request of the world is that you see yourself. And so I was trying to please others. Their request of me, they're only asking me a little thing of me, you know, just like, we're just asking that you learn to see yourself. You cannot see yourself. Being, we are being seen, but what is being seen? Being is being seen. Not a self. Not a person. Not a seer. There's no seer that is being seen. So, what we have to do is recognize that the fundamental request of us as we come into this world, it's not a little thing at all. It's a total request, a death request, death wish. It's basically saying, all we want for you is that you wish to die. Is that you wish to be enslaved. That you learn to see yourself. I say, oh, we only have one request. We only have one request of you. Well, it only takes one request. If that request is impossible, to throw us on a path of futility. They say, oh, we're not asking much of you. We just, that you work towards seeing yourself. What we are, we cannot see what we are. What we are is seen. And we can see that we're being seen, as it were. We're aware of it. There's an awareness that we're being seen. And that is the communication with God, actually. But we're aware that everything is being seen. Equally. We're aware of this equal vision. And this awareness is then communication, actually, with God. So what we're really told in this world, all we ask of you is that you separate from God. That's it. That's what we want of you. So we have to fail to satisfy an insane request. This is hitting hard, because it's true. I remember that that's the start. What you do in inquiry is keep inquiring until something hits you really hard. And then you know, yeah, you're getting there. You're onto it. It's like you're eating the ghost pepper. At some point we have to eat the ghost pepper. Why not now? And realize that our entire life has been this scam. We've sacrificed being seen, everything being seen, in order to try to become a seer. In order to see ourself, this so-called self. Personal self. We just, all we wanted to do just to be a person. Yeah, you give up heaven for that. You give up heaven for hell. That's all that this request is. It's only requesting you give up heaven for hell. And then when you complain, the ego says, you can have both. If you want both, you want to be selfish, have both, go ahead. No, you can't have both. So I have to choose between the two. So when you do inquiry until something hits real, real hard. You eat a ghost pepper, you chew on it, and you say, it's kind of flavorful, got a nice, interesting taste and smell, and it's kind of, not bad at all, not bad at all. Keep chewing, keep chewing, keep chewing, and then the slow burn, it starts. Inquiries like that. And then when you get hit hard, you say less. Become kind of quiet, just like you eat a ghost pepper. People are talking and chatting, and hey, this should be fun, it's not that hot, it's no big deal. And check back a little while later, and they're not saying much of anything. So it's like that. In a metaphorical sense, like my nerves are being hit by this. It hurts to see, you know, that you've been trying to fulfill an insane request your whole life. Basically, they say, you know, your request, the request is that you do the impossible, and you say, well, you know, it's too difficult. I don't think I can do that. And they say, well, if you want to do the other also, you know, as a side thing, that's okay. That's what they say. If you want to drop that and be everything seen as a side gig, that's a fine. But as long as you do the other also, yeah, they seem to be very, very reasonable, flexible, as it were. This is the trap. And what hits us is that we realize we could have experienced being seen in the scene, truly in the scene, our entire lives, and yet we've wasted our entire lives trying to see instead of accepting everything being seen. What was that? So it's like a ton of bricks, for sure, but at some point, we're like eating little bits of ghost pepper, little bits, at some point, you'd eat the whole thing and finish it. But actually, the truth is that we've been eating it bit by bit by bit by bit by bit, and so there's only a little bit left, actually. And we think, oh, this must be the super hot part. No, they were all hot parts. You know, because we ate it bit by bit by bit with some lime juice, it wasn't so bad. You know, if we tried to eat it all at once, yeah, it would have been ferocious. But bit by bit by bit by bit, and we keep thinking, okay, where's the hot part, the real hot part? And it must be this last piece, must be just, you know, all the heat's there. No, it's pretty much the same as the others. I mean, we've already gotten used to the heat, etc. So it's not hotter than the other parts. I'm not experiencing anything stronger than other, you know, realizations. And we may say, well, that wasn't so bad. Well, it was bad because of the time it took. So you can either eat it all at once or eat it bit by bit. The disillusionment. And we're afraid, I think we're afraid that if we experience being seen, that we'll realize we could have been experiencing this our entire lives, and we didn't, and that's just like so disappointing, you know. Wow. I'm a little afraid of that. The ego counts on that. That's why it says, just do it for a little while. But then after you do it for a little while, you realize, well, gosh, I could have been experiencing being seen this whole time. And you think, oh, I'd be so disappointed. I better keep doing this. And so the ego knows that we have this problem. Well, let's find out how bad the burn is. You know, let's find out. You could say, I've been burned. This whole time I've been burned. That is right. But the burn is over. So it's at some point, I guess that eventually I would say would wear off the sense of disappointment that you've been, you know, burned for your whole life of being burned. So the way I'm looking at it is being seen, everything being seen, that experience is, you know, actually very sobering kind of thing, the situation. And it's not something that initially one is necessarily should be all euphoric and wow, you know, because there needs to be a period of just recognizing just how you badly misspent your time. There's bound to be some of that reverberating. So you can matter of fact the situation. Okay, everything is being seen. Okay. It's kind of a glum thing, actually. the ego tells us, well, how come you're not euphoric, you know, and then tries to get you off of it. But it's kind of a glum thing. It's like living in hell, and you realize you never had to live there at all. You never had to live there at all. It's just stupidity, you know, that and it's regret, you know, you have regret for being so stupid. And you can say, well, you know, I was under too much pressure, which is all that is true. But the bottom line is, nobody has to be experiencing hell at all. Everything has been seen continuously. This being seen, this hasn't just started now, it's always been there. The key is everything is being seen equally. You cannot portray this. In other words, you can't see it. The seer can't see it like as an artwork, as music, as in any form. You can't see it in a form. Pure seeing, everything being seen, that is the picture. That is the artwork. That is the form. So all these people who say how much they're into art, they say, great, okay, you know, if you're really into art, then see the ultimate art. It cannot be represented. It is the representation. It's the one representation that can't be represented. Can't do both. Because if you're looking at something else, you're not looking at it. You're not seeing. You're not being seen. You're still seeing. So you can't. You cannot paint a picture of it. It's not possible. That just strengthens the seer. The seer says, I don't need it. I'm able to see this, and therefore I don't need to be seen. But everything being seen is the great picture. That's the great art. That's pure art. Everything else is an attempt to undo pure art. So people want to say, well, I just want a beautiful form of this undoing. That doesn't solve the continuity issue. They say, I can't get to the... Well, people have got to the pure art. So they say they can't get to it. It's not true. The eye can't, seeing can't get to it. But seeing is always what is seeing what has been undone, which is a fantasy. So we want to see a fantasy of undoing pure art. Strengthen the seerness. Because the seer will say, well, I have something really great to see, so I don't need to see pure art. Pure art is being seen. The true artist is the one that's being seen. It's allowing seeing being to happen. Pure seeing, which is being seen. Everything being seen, that is true art. So all we have to do is step into true art. Pure art. Step into pure art. Step into pure art. People will say, it's too hot, it's too much. Well, if you approach it, that's what the spiritual path is all about. That's, you know, you have to approach it and get familiar with it enough. Or spend time at it. People say, well, I don't have any time to spend at it. Well, you can spend a little time at it. That's how you start. See, everyone's so busy with the ego that they say, I don't have any time for the Holy Spirit. So it's not fair. Well, you have to make time. But they say, well, the ego won't like that. Well, that's right, the ego won't like that. Can't please both the ego and God. It's not possible. So the ego will be displeased, of course. Then we think, well, but I'm so great that the ego should love me too. No, the attempt to annihilate ourselves does not love what we are. We have to give up that attempt. And then people give a little attempt, and then they say, okay, the ego said that's enough, okay. So the ego let me do a little bit, and now I'm back full tilt with the ego. And it doesn't work that way. See, what the world is hoping for is great artists. That's the ego. The muse is the one that keeps whining and complaining. Come on, you can, you know, trying to motivate great art in the world instead of pure art. You don't say, I'm seeing pure art. You say, I'm experiencing pure art. I'm experiencing pure art. Pure art is free, and pure art is unbounded, it's not owned by anyone. You have the sense of ownership, and you step into pure art. Last night before I went to sleep, I said, okay, I accept, I'm going to give up everything. I don't own anything. I have absolutely nothing, no ownership of anything. And I was absolutely willing to do that. give up all personal ownership of art, and you will see pure art. You'll experience pure art. You won't see it, you'll experience it. You will realize that you can't own this. You can't own it. Nobody can own it. Because it's everything. And maybe the art collector will say, I don't want this, I can't own it, what good is it for me? I want to own, you know, I want the sense of ownership of great art. Really, what has to take place is the death of the artist. No more artist. If you want to experience pure art, there's no more artist. Of course, no more artist, there's no more art critic either. Now we know that clarity will kind of get obscured by some clouds as we go about our day, but it's just getting familiar with this is what's important. Again, this is what Jesus said to do, Last Supper. Take the unleavened bread, which is the truth, clarity about what is true, the facts, and then get familiar with these facts. Give it time. Time of familiarity. Give it some time. The ego expects you to get it like that and then get back to what it wants you to do. Say, come on, give me a 5-minute synopsis and then I'm busy. I need to get back to my video game. Doesn't work that way. Because you have to feel the burn, as it were, and experience that you can get through it. Get used to it. The disappointment. Let the disappointment dissipate. As you realize you'll never be a great artist. A great artist only experiences art, but what we can experience is pure art. We are pure art. We are one with the pure art. That is better than being an artist, a great artist. Again, that other stuff is just trying to undo pure art. How can you be great at that? How can you be truly great at that? That's ridiculous. It's a meaningless statement. And we say, well, okay, I'll never be great. Yeah, that's true. But great is a meaningless statement. We'll be pure. There's only purity and a futile attempt to undo purity. That's it. So how can there be any category of greatness? There isn't. Again, we come into the world and people say, all I want you to do is to be great. I got low expectations. I just want you to be great. I mean, I want you to be impure. I want you to try to undo purity. So the whole purpose of inquiry is to get hit hard like this. Get hit hard. Make sure you get hit hard. And give yourself time to absorb the impact, as it were, of this. And don't get into, you know, mind games, word games. Try to just stay with the feeling of getting hit hard. And it's always possible to play word games. Always possible to go mental on it or go conceptual on it. And say, what do you mean by greatest? What do you mean by this great? Forget it. And once you get hit hard, just stay with that. Don't worry about trying to explain to those who don't want to feel the impact of it. You cannot. Whole point, again, of words is to just get us to where we feel the impact of our folly. Just keep breathing. Just keep breathing when you feel the impact of your folly. Say, oh my gosh, what utter folly. Yeah. Just keep breathing. That's all. When the impact of your folly is felt and seen, recognized, but what I just experienced is that all the little tunes that are playing in your head, little jingles, tunes maybe, they're gone. The clever thoughts are gone. All that stuff sort of recedes, and then it eventually starts seeping back in. You'll find yourself humming a song or tune or thinking about something like that. Back to trying to be an artist. Again, you choose between being an artist and being art itself. Being an artist is actually an attempt to undo art itself. Who wants to be the greatest artist? What is that? You never reach it. There's no such thing. If there's no such thing as the greatest artist, why even bother? Because there is no undoing. Now, I speak this way because I was involved in trying to be the greatest artist. I've spent a lot of efforts in that direction. So I'm speaking in these terms. There are other terms you could use. Business people, you know, those who try to be the greatest business person, they may use different terminology. Those who try to be the greatest this or that, you know, can use different terminology. It doesn't matter. It's all pointing to the same way. But many of us try to be great artists in all different ways, many different ways. So this is this way of speaking like this has a wide resonance, actually. I can't please everyone. I mean, I could speak in different terms, but for now, just stay with this resonance of art, very strong resonance. How can we be the greatest at futility? Well, we made the longest effort toward futility, but how is that great? I mean, what's the payoff? Nothing. It's like those say, well, I've put in so much effort, it's going to be too upsetting for me to accept that I, you know, failed at it. It's all futile. Well, if I can do it, anybody can do it. I put in such a huge effort and thought I had gone so far, and everybody's saying how great I was, and so I've had to let myself down from all of this. It's taken a lifetime, actually. So it can take quite some time if you really pursue that. But it's not impossible to do, and you have to, you've got no choice, but you have to do it. You have to let yourself down and be disillusioned from that. So, everyone can do it. Everyone has to do it. Doesn't matter. The one who tries the longest, it just means that they'll have probably a little longer spiritual path of letting themselves down, sure. Take a little longer, maybe. That's okay. Holy Spirit's got all the time it needs. It's in charge of time, so however much time it needs, it has that much time. Remember, the ego's goal is to get you to invest so severely that you say, there's no way I can possibly disinvest. It's too much. That's what it wants for everyone. That's its trick. So, of course, most of us will be heavily invested by the time we start realizing we need to disinvest. We'll say, oh my gosh, it's just asking too much. That's the trick we've put on ourselves. But bit at a time. That is why great spiritual realizers say, look, if you're going to be on the spiritual path, just take it. It's going to be a lifetime affair. It's a lifetime affair. It's a lifetime affair, absolutely. Because almost inevitably, your investment is so great that to disinvest is going, you need to go bit by bit. Because your fear of it's going to be too overwhelming to realize that I've spent all this time in turning my back on this, you know, pure art. Trying to please the ego. Trying to undo it. of course, if you're trying to undo it, you're going to turn your back on it. Because if you don't, you would see that it can't be undone. And you wouldn't try it all. So in order to try it all, one has to turn one's back on it. And we don't have to be great at undoing it either. That can get in the way too. There's still that element of greatness. I want to be great at something. No, I want to be pure. I want to not be pure. I want to experience the purity, which is nothing to do with greatness. It's beyond any greatness. Greatness refers to trying to undo it. There's no meaningful term you can give it in terms of greatness. Ego saying, well, how can you be great? You're just sitting there. You're not saying anything, you're just sitting there. And some people will say, well, I can be great at just sitting here. No, that's not the point. I'm only sitting here because of the impact of seeing the folly. That's why. See, a lot of people think that they can be great at the spiritual path. And so they study, like they imitate the mannerisms. Okay, I need to sit quietly. Okay, I can be great at that too. I can sit quietly. Now, I'm sitting quietly because the impact of this realization, seeing this, is just like very intense. So, you do have those who think that they're great, and they can be great at anything. And the spiritual path, no problem. I can be great at that too. No problem, Guru. What? How do I be great at the path? You know, nah, it's not like that at all. It's like if you eat a ghost pepper, it's going to be hot. I know a lot of people said, "Oh, I'm great with hot stuff." Oh yeah, I'm really great with it. I love spicy stuff. I'm great at that. You got something hot? Oh, I'll be great with that too. And then you give them ghost pepper, and later on you say, hey, you want another? No. Not great at it. You can't be great at the spiritual path. Yes, that's the final realization, I don't know, but it's that, hey, I've not been great at it at all. Because the effort to be great at it gets in the way. You have to accept less than greatness on it. Not great at it. Because, again, like the ghost pepper, people think being great means they're not going to feel the heat. That's not true. When they discover that they do feel the heat, and it's, you know, too much and all this. I mean, well, it's not too much, but it's so intense and they can't, you know, get rid of it. Then they feel defeated, like they're not great, and they don't want anything more to do with that. I've noticed this so many, many, many times of people. It's just a study in what's going on in the world to have ghost peppers. Here, you want a ghost pepper, this, you want to try this. And everybody. Well, there's two different types. You can just tell what's going on with people, where they're at. Those who want to say that they're great, say, oh yeah, it's a challenge, I could be great at that. And others who've been humbled a bit by life say, no, just take a little bit, just a little bit at a time. There's some will say, sure, I'll take it, but I'm going to eat it with food, I'm just going to take a little bit at a time, and you know, then you know there's something going on there with them. They're not trying to be great. So, I guess the realization is we're not great with the spiritual path. I've not been great at it at all. Great with it at all. Absolutely not. How can anyone be great at letting go of greatness? In other words, the disappointment, saying great in spiritual path means I don't feel any disappointment at all, I just sail right through. No, it doesn't work that way. There's great feeling of folly, disappointment, sorrow over being so, wasting all of your life, being so deceived, everything. Stay with it, stay with it. Those who are trying to be great will say, okay, I got it. You know, next, okay, I'm ready for the next thing. That's nothing. Well, they didn't really get it then. they're not staying with it. So it's superficial. They're making it into something superficial that greatness can chew on. Someone working on being great, sounds like. The realization is I'll never be great. I mean, that's the understanding. Oh my gosh, I'll never be great. And then we get back to the technique which I have given out, which is I'll never be great. I'll never succeed. Doing that, I find it's a tremendous help. And again, you don't have to be great at it, right? Just do it. Don't be great at it, just do it. Those who want to be great at it, they stop doing it. And they say, okay, now wait a minute, how can I be great at this? And they're thinking, how can I be great at this instead of actually doing it? Because really I'm doing the whole notion of greatness. I'll never be great. I'll never be great at anything. I'll never be great at anything. So it's like a humbling. It's a humbling process. The spiritual path is like a humbling process. For a purpose, though, not just to be great at humbling oneself. No, not trying to be great at humbling. I won't be great at anything. I'll never be great at anything, including being humble. That's true. Never be great at being humble. No, because being seen is pure. And there's really nothing meaningful that can be said about it, including humility. All of those things are dualistic concepts. Purity is not, does not touch that. So, we're not going to be, I'll never be great at anything. I'll never be great at being humble. I'll never be great on the spiritual path. See, a lot of us take the spiritual path as the ultimate in being great at something. I said, if I can be great at the spiritual path, then I'll truly reach true greatness. And then if we hope that then we'll be seen. There will be a point of focus, of being seen. Instead of experiencing everything being seen simultaneously, equally. So I'll never be great at humility. I'll never be great at the spiritual path. I'll never be great at the spiritual path. That is true. I'll never be great at anything. I'll never be great at humility. I'll never be great at humility. I'll never be great at inquiry. I'll never be great at the spiritual path. These are realizations hitting hard. There is underneath there's a sense of humor about it all. So it's not like you're entirely depressed. There certainly is a impact of it all, but underneath it, there's this buoyancy underneath it. So you don't really, it's kind of like you're jettisoning stuff. It's kind of like you're in this plane and you're jettisoning all the stuff. You say, my gosh, I'll never be able to take this with me. I throw it away. I'll never be able to take this with me. And you feel so sad, I'll never be great at anything. But every time you jettison something, the plane gets lighter and lighter and lighter. And after a while, you jettison everything and you realize, oh my gosh, I'm flying. And so the buoyancy increases as you experience this letdowns. You're throwing away your hopes of greatness. Tossing him aside. But the result is buoyancy. See, I'll never be great at buoyancy. That's also true. I'll never be great at throwing things, tossing, jettisoning stuff. That is true. Never be great. I'll never be great at anything. Because in the face of purity, the term greatness is meaningless. No meaning to it. No one will ever be great at anything. We can say I, we can also say no one. No one will ever be great at anything. That is a fact. This is hitting real hard. No one will ever be great at anything. No one has ever been great at anything. No one will ever be great at anything. No one. There's never been any greatness. Never will be. No one will ever be great at anything. Very sobering, because who wants to hang around where there's no greatness? You know, the whole idea of this is, you know, we're among greatness, we can find greatness. No, no one will ever be great at anything. See, the idea of the demagogues arising, all this stuff, is people, so people can think, oh, I'm with greatness. No. But the realization is no one is great ever, will ever be great at anything. We're not among greatness. You go see the guru, you think, oh, I'm with something great. I'm hanging out with greatness. No. The guru is not great. Guru is pure. The guru is being seen. Pure is being purely seen, along with everything else, is being purely seen by God, by the Holy Spirit. So the guru is not great. Nothing is great. Strong. But we're doing it. There's no problems. Because underneath, the buoyancy is getting better. You can't find a great guru. There is no such thing, actually. I know I used to say this guru is a great guru, etc., but I'm seeing it now in a more clear light. The reason why I can never find a great guru in the world here is because there is no such thing. There is no such thing. Nothing is great in itself, nothing. Again, there's purity in concepts such as greatness, etc., don't apply at all. All concepts are an attempt to undo the purity, to undo it. And since it cannot happen, they're all meaningless. So how can you attain meaninglessness? What is that? That in itself is attaining. Attaining meaningless is no attainment. So you might say there's no attainment at all, really. Nothing to attain. There's no attainment. I'll never attain anything. No one will ever attain anything. This has to be felt. There's an inner feeling to all this, a feeling like, wow. But it's great. The feeling is just like, wow. Very sobering. But you have to experience it for yourself. There's a disillusionment. The mind says, well, just tell me what it's like, and then I'll experience what it's like. It doesn't work that way. It doesn't work that way. It's like saying, what is purity like? Okay. Like impurity? I mean, if something's pure, how can you say, what is it like? Meaningless. You know, like that's like asking, what is the greatest form of meaninglessness? People are afraid they'll be completely bummed out, but I'm not completely bummed out. No, not at all. That's the point of these videos, is to go through this and show that even though there's this kind of like letdown, it's actually results in buoyancy. You have to just experience the letdown. Consciously embrace the letdown, as it were, not as trying to do it in a great manner. I'll never be great at anything. that's the great letdown. It's also the great opportunity, if we can get to this and able to actually. It's not even a great opportunity. I'll never have a great opportunity. I keep saying, I'll never have a great opportunity. There's another one. I'll never have a great opportunity. In other words, I'll never have an opportunity for greatness. So, even though this stuff seems difficult, it's actually the very best stuff possible, really. I'll never have an opportunity for greatness. You're coming in the world, and everybody says, you're here, you're finally here. You've seen your opportunity for greatness. How awesome. You know? No. If you have this realization, you will never get tricked again. I'll never have an opportunity for greatness. Idea is to die before you die. This is a dying before you die. So I'm showing it's possible. Now, how functional I am? Perfectly, perfectly functional. I'll never have an opportunity for greatness. Am I aware of the day? Of course. Sunday. The time, look at your watch. 11:30. The weather? Spectacular. I'm aware of hunger. I need to get breakfast. All of that. There's no problem with functionality whatsoever. But there's this kind of this quote-unquote burn going on. Like I'll never have an opportunity for greatness. It's like, oh my gosh, that's what I forgot to remember. Wow. So that's it. So there's this sort of like disappointment, like, oh my gosh, I fooled myself this whole time. I was seeking for an opportunity for greatness. There is no such thing. I'll never have an opportunity for greatness. I'll never have an opportunity for greatness. If you can get to that one, I'll never have an opportunity for greatness. Then instead of being like depressed, in the back of your mind, you've got to know that you are crossing the finish line. You're crossing the finish line as you say that and can accept it. You're literally are crossing, quote unquote, the finish line. which isn't really there. You can say, I'll never cross the finish line. I'll never have an opportunity to cross any finish line. When you realize that, what, the finish line is gone. The race is over. It's only because we saw a finish line that we're racing. I'll never have our opportunity for greatness. I can't even be great at realizing I never had an opportunity for, I'll never have an opportunity for greatness. I won't be great at that either. So? We'll see how it goes. I have to get breakfast. You see, if we go into this with the right focus, knowing this is what we're aiming for, and then when it happens, we say, okay, that's great. Like if you eat the ghost pepper, you say, okay, I'm gonna eat it. I know it's gonna be hot. I know the heat will last for a while, and then it'll dissipate, and then I'll feel, wow, I got through it. Then it's not a problem. It's not a problem. You don't freak out at all. When we say, no, I want this profound letdown. I want to accept this, to admit it, acknowledge it, to recognize it. I want to recognize it. So so it's a great thing. It's not a problem. Okay, very great. That's it. Go get some breakfast.